Said to them, "Each one of you must turn away from your sins and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins will be forgiven, and you will receive God's gift, the Holy Spirit. For God's promise was made to you and your children, and to all who are far away, all whom the Lord our God calls to himself." Peter made his appeal to them, and with many other words he urged them, saying, "Save yourselves from the punishment coming to this wicked people." Many of them believed his message and were baptized, and about 3,000 people were added to the group that day. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. A reading from the first letter of Saint Peter, chapter 1, beginning to read at verse 17. Peter writes, "You call him Father when you pray to God, who judges all people by the same standard, according to what each one has done. So then, spend the rest of your lives here on earth in reverence for him. For you know what was paid to set you free from the worthless manner of life handed down by your ancestors. It was not something that can be destroyed, such as silver or gold. It was the costly sacrifice of Christ, who was like a lamb without defect or flaw. He had been chosen by God before the creation of the world and was revealed in these last days for your sake. Through him, you believed in God, who raised him from death and gave him glory. So your faith and hope are fixed on God. Now that by your obedience to the truth, you have purified yourselves and have come to a sincere love for other believers, love one another earnestly with all your hearts. For through the living and eternal word of God, you have been born again as the children of a parent who is immortal, not mortal. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel is written in the 24th chapter of the Gospel according to St. Luke, verses 13 to 35.
Glory to Christ our Savior.
The walk to Emmaus. On that same day, two of Jesus' followers were going to a village named Emmaus, about 11 kilometers from Jerusalem, and were talking to each other about all the things that had happened. As they talked and discussed, Jesus himself drew near and walked along with them. They saw him, but somehow did not recognize him. Jesus said to them, "What are you talking about to each other as you walk along?" They stood still with set faces. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only visitor in Jerusalem who doesn't know the things that have been happening there these last few days?" "What things?" he asked. "The things that happened to Jesus of Nazareth," they answered. "This man was a prophet and was considered by God and by all the people to be powerful in everything he said and did. Our chief priests and rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and he was crucified. And we had hoped that he would be one who was going to set Israel free. Besides all that, this is now the third day since it happened. Some of the women of our group surprised us. They went at dawn to the tomb, but could not find his body. They came back saying that they had seen a vision of angels who told them that he is alive. Some of our group went to the tomb and found it exactly as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then Jesus said to them, "How foolish you are! How slow you are to believe everything the prophets said. Was it not necessary for the Messiah to suffer these things and then to enter his glory?" And Jesus explained to them what was said about himself in all the scriptures, beginning with the books of Moses and the writings of all the prophets. As they came near the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he were going farther. But they held him back, saying, "Stay with us. The day is almost over, and it is getting dark." So he went in to stay with them. He sat down to eat with them, took the bread, and said the blessing. Then he took the bread and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. But he disappeared from their sight. They said to each other, "Was it like a fire burning in us when he talked to us on the road and explained scriptures to us?" They got up at once and went back to Jerusalem, where they found the 11 disciples gathered together with the others and saying, "The Lord is risen indeed. He has appeared to Simon." The two then explained to them what had happened on the road and how they recognized the Lord when they broke the bread. This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to Christ, our Lord.
Luke chapter 24, verses 13 to 35. It's a striking text because it tells us so very much about human situation. It illustrates the kind of false assumptions we have about what God should do for us, and as well as demonstrating God's patience and His mercy with us. It could just as well have been you or I who met Jesus on the Emmaus Road. For many of us would have spoken and acted just as did Cleopas and the other disciple when they talked unknowingly with the risen Lord. Our passage deals with the two disciples who were talking about what had happened the last few days: the arrest, trial, crucifixion, and now the body of Jesus is not where it was buried. The disciples did not yet understand Christ's purpose. They had a glimpse of it, but their ideas of that purpose were confused. Their understanding of what God and Jesus meant by redemption was warped or wrongly understood. Jesus' mighty deeds and words have kindled in their hearts the expectation that He was the Christ who was to redeem Israel. Their hopes, however, centered in the restoration of Israel as an independent nation to which the scattered Jews could return from far and near places of exile. They were looking for a lost dignity and a new equality, a fulfillment of God's promise to right the injustices so much a part of world's political, economic, and social systems. Now, do we today understand God's purpose, or are we still confused, doubting His death, His resurrection, and His power to save? Are we blinded by things of this world? Does Easter, the resurrection of Christ, mean anything to us, or make any difference in our life? God's purpose is to save us from the power of darkness, from evil, from eternal death. He died to pay the penalty for our sins, to make us His own, and lastly, to bring us to Himself. And that was why He died on the cross, to redeem us. And Easter should change our lives, should open our spiritual eyes to experience and understand God better, to see and hear Him clearer, love Him dearer, follow Him closer, faithful to Him forever, and see others better. The two followers, or the two disciples who met Jesus, I'm sure they were certain that the tomb was empty. The women informed them about it. The women had seen a vision of angels who told them that He is alive in verses 22 to 24. But unfortunately, their minds, their hearts were still closed. Jesus drew near, walked with them, talked with them. The Bible tells us that they saw Jesus, but somehow did not recognize him. Jesus explained to them what was said about himself in all the scriptures, beginning from the books of Moses and the writings of all the prophets. Now, there are people who have read the Bible from cover to cover, study the Bible, talk about God, but not to be enlightened, but to find faults or some illogical statements in it. And they will use their findings to attack and discredit Christian faith. These people may spend years reading the Bible, but they will never get to acquire a real knowledge of God. Such knowledge cannot be acquired through lecture, study, and debate. It must be experienced. To understand God's will is to experience God's will in our lives. Yes, it is important to read and to study the Bible. But we cannot really understand the Bible without the help of the Holy Spirit of God. What I'm trying to say is, to understand His purpose, to know God, to be changed, to experience the love of the risen Lord, we need to be open to the Holy Spirit, to invite God into our lives. The two disciples invited Jesus into their home. Jesus took the bread and said the blessing. Then he broke the bread and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized Jesus. They said to one another, "Wasn't it like fire burning in us when he talked to us on the road and explained the scriptures to us?" Their eyes were open simply because they allowed Jesus to come inside and to stay with them. The scriptures, the risen Lord, became so real to them, and it can be so to them, to us, if we allow Jesus to come into our lives. Their eyes were open. They recognized Jesus. As I've mentioned earlier, the disciples' hope and expectations were wrong. They had the wrong perspective about the ministry of Jesus. They desired a political Messiah who would liberate Judah from the tyranny of Roman oppression. Their priorities were wrong. Cleopas and his friend were spiritually blind because their focus on their problems, their sorrows, their hardships, and their disappointments. Therefore, they could not see and recognize Jesus. Softly, please, brothers and sisters in Christ, do not let the things of this world deceive us. Lord, do not let our desires blind us from knowing the truth from experiencing the love and the joy of the risen Lord. Let the Holy Spirit shift our eyes from our problems, our sorrows, our hardships, and our disappointments, and get our eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith. When we encounter Jesus, we experience victory over our problems, our sorrows, our hardships, and our disappointments. The two disciples experienced the joy of the risen Lord only because they personally invited Jesus into their home. Brothers and sisters in Christ, have you personally encountered Jesus? If not, Jesus is now inviting you to come to him. And at the same time, let us open our hearts to him, to come to his table, to receive him, the bread and the wine. Well, of course, I know that we are unable to do so because of the situations that we are in at the moment. But still, we can receive him if we allow him to come into our lives. He wants to reveal himself to us, to talk to us personally, especially through his words, the Bible. Are you willing to come, to invite him, to let the truth of the risen Lord burn in your hearts and change you to be more like him, to understand him better? Lastly, when Jesus disappeared from their sight, they got up immediately and returned to Jerusalem to share their joy with the other disciples. They had to witness. They said, "We have seen the Lord. He is risen indeed." And that is exactly what the Holy Spirit leads you and I to do when we encounter Jesus. Can we do the same? Friends, Jesus has risen from the dead. Do not doubt anymore. His purpose is clear: to save us. He wants to be invited into our lives to change us, to renew us, to make us his own. Let him speak to us through his word, the Bible, his sacraments, and lastly, he wants us to be his witness, and as well as to make disciples. Remember in Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, he says, "Go then to all peoples everywhere and make them my disciples. Baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit." Verse 20, "And teach them to obey everything I've commanded you, and I will be with you always to the end of age." In the name of God the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
And now shall we affirm our faith by reciting the Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate of the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray.
In joy and hope, let us pray to the Father. Almighty God, through the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, your people are filled with boldness and fresh hope. Strengthen us to proclaim his risen life and the message of peace to the world for your glory. Renew and strengthen your church throughout the world. Guide Donald, our bishop, Nelson, the assistant bishop, Thong Meng, our Dean, and all in the service of Christ. May we live as those who believe in the triumph of the cross, that all people may know and receive the good news of Christ's victory. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Cover with your mercy and protection the nations of the world and all its people amidst the COVID-19 outbreak that is threatening the globe, especially the vulnerable and elderly, those in the front line of treating the sick and suffering, those providing and serving for the necessities of our daily lives, and those ensuring our peace and safety. Grant wisdom to all the leaders of the nations to contain the scourge and spread of the pandemic. Grant scientists and researchers a speedy breakthrough for an effective vaccine, treatment, and cure. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bring healing to this broken world, peace to the nations and abundance to the earth. Bless the Federation of Malaysia and the state of Sarawak. Guide all who rule over us and those in authority under them, and order our lives in justice and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Fill our homes with joy and peace. Bless our family, friends, and all who we love. Give us the grace to serve one another and love as Christ has commanded us. Keep us safe in the comfort of our beloved, and may your presence bind us closer as we dwell in your abiding peace. in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heal the sick, the weak, and the dying, especially those suffering in isolation amidst the virus outbreak. Be the strength and life of those who are on medical support. Strengthen them with faith and assure them with your never-failing presence. Lift them out of darkness and despair and into the light and joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Welcome into your kingdom all who have died in the faith of the resurrection, especially for Betty Leong and Deborah Kachandai, the recently departed, and all whom we remember in your name. According to Christ's promises, may all be raised on the last day. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Rejoicing in the fellowship of St. Thomas the Apostle, our patron, and the Blessed Virgin Mary, and all your saints, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray unto your unfailing love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.